Thank you. स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। Namaskar to all of you. Welcome to the study of the life of Sharadanandaji Maharaj, one of the direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna, who has written the life of Sri Ramakrishna, that is Ramakrishna, the great master of the Leela Prasanga. Yesterday, we went through one of the incidents from the life of Sharadanandaji Maharaj, where two scientists came to argue with Sharadanandaji Maharaj, and we will go through that again. What happened then? Doubt is a horrible disease of the human mind. An illumined teacher, a realized soul, always tries to remove the doubts of his disciples. In 1925, two young scientists came to Calcutta to visit Sharadananda at Udbodhan. One of them asked, "Does God exist?" "Yes," replied Swami Sharadananda. One of the scientists told, "What is the proof?" To which Sharadananda replied, "The words of the rishis, the seers of the truth, the saints, we have written them, recorded them down from time immemorial. Thousands of the millions of saints have recorded them in the form of Vedas, Upanishads, Puranas." To which another scientist replied, "There may be a possibility of those rishis and munis making mistakes." Again, Sharadananda told, "Is it possible that all the thousands and millions of saints and rishis have made mistakes?" scientist replied to that, I won't believe without experiencing God myself. Very well, said the Swami. Is it possible that you will only believe after seeing everything yourself? Suppose you have never been in England. You will have to know about England from those who have visited it. Although you have not seen it, you cannot deny the existence of England. Likewise, God exists. You will have to trust the judgment of those who have seen him. After seeing God, after experiencing God, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa said to all, I have seen God. You can also see him through spiritual disciplines and longing, Vyakulata, for God. In this scientific age, Sri Ramakrishna came to dispel the doubts of the people by demonstrating religion. The young scientists were convinced and accepted Sharadananda's words. Yesterday, after going through this incident, I told you, I'll be taking you through some more facts by which we can also understand, get the proof that God exists. There was a personality development trainer. He was taking a class to the people who had come to that particular workshop for personality development. While he was talking about faith in God, by which you can very well easily develop your personality, one of the attendees of the workshop told, Sir, does God exist? Yes. To which that attendee asked the personality development trainer, Have you experienced God? No. Then how can you tell without first experiencing it yourself that God exists? When you have not seen God, or when you have not seen a thing, how can you have so much of faith in it? Then the personality development trainer asked him, Yes, can you explain me what is poison? What happens if you consume poison? Then the attendee told, If you consume poison, people will die. Have you experienced that? Have you consumed poison? Have you experienced that any time? How do you know that? Have you ever consumed poison? Have you experienced that after taking poison you have died? No. How can I do that? After I consume poison, I will die. No, have you experienced it? How can you believe that you will die? No. Then how do you know it? I have heard it from people, those who have consumed it. Did they come back after dying to tell you that they die after poison? No. Then how did you believe it? The doctors, the experts have experimented and told that. Yes, in the similar way, the experts of the Vedas, the rishis, the munis, the saints, they have experienced God and they have told us, they have recorded it in our scriptures. So those who have already experienced that, they have told us, so we believe in God. Then that attendee kept quiet. And out of the 100 people who had attended that personality development workshop, the personality development trainer asked them, amongst these 100 trainees in the workshop, how many believe in God, how many deny God? Out of them, all the 95 told, we believe in God. The rest 5 told, we don't. believe in God. Yes, you have the right to have your beliefs. Nobody can force you. You have all the freedom to not believe in God. Okay, the personality development trainer told. How do you believe? When will you believe in God? To those five people. They told, we will believe when you give the proof. Then he asked one of the five members, let us, now I will give you proof, I will prove that God exists. Let us go out of the hall to the garden. Yes, he asked one of the five persons, where do you live? Where are you from? I'm from Bombay. Where do you live in the Bombay? In that particular area, car or something like that, Worli. Then, where is your house? It is situated on the 7th floor of the apartment complex. How do you take bath? By shower. I go to the bathroom and open the shower and water comes. Where does that water come to the shower? It comes from the tank on the top of the apartment. And where does that water to that tank come from? From the lower, at the bottom of the apartment, there is a sump tank and water get collected there. Then how does that water rise up to the tank which is on the top from the sump tank, lower tank? There is a motor to pump it. Why can't the water go to the top of the tank without the motor? Why can't it rise up by itself? How can it? There is gravity. Water cannot flow. Water always flows downwards. Wherever there is least resistance, water can't fly. It cannot go up to the upper tank without the motor. It needs force to push it. Now, the personality development trainer showed at the coconut tree which was nearby. It was nearly 100 feet, very tall. Then he told, can you show me the motor in this coconut tree which is taking up the water from the ground to the coconut which is 100 feet top? There is no motor. Then how did that water go up? Why do you need water here? There is gravity too here. The water cannot flow upwards, it will go downwards. But here in the coconut tree, the coconuts are 100 feet on the top. And how did that water without the motor go to the top? Then the personality development trainer asked, while they were performing the gymnastics or the workout in the gym in the morning, in that workshop there was also the yoga and also workout in the gym. So one of that person who told, I don't believe in God, was sweating. Told, why are you wiping your face and body? Because I'm sweating. How did the sweat come from? We have pores on the skin. All over the skin, all over our body, we have millions and millions of pores. And they have sweat gland and the sweats collect there and comes out. Oh, there are so many pores, holes in your skin from which the sweat comes out when you work out. Yes. Then you are now after that workout, you go to the swimming pool and you jump into the water and swim there in the water. Why doesn't the water enter into your body through those pores? Thousands, millions of pores are there in your body. Only the water or the sweat comes out. But why doesn't the water go inside your body through that millions of pores when you dip yourself into the water in the swimming pool? No answer. Then so many people are writing something, so many people are typing on the typewriter. There are so many people who are typing on the keyboard of the computer and the old typewriter. They used to type so much. Millions and millions of people have typed, making that sound when you type on the typewriter or you write on the book, chatter-patter sound. you allow hundreds of monkeys, hundreds of millions of monkeys to type on the typewriter. They too will imitate the man, ape the man by typing on the typewriter. Can they produce one poem of Shakespeare? Can they produce one poem written by a great saint? Can they produce one novel of the Shakespeare or some other great person? Millions of monkeys may be tapping on the typewriter. Can it produce a poem? Can you produce a novel? It cannot. So you see this cosmos. What is the meaning of this cosmos? Everything is perfectly arranged. Not one single mistake. The earth is revolving around the sun with so much of precision. Every day, 24 hours, there is one rotation. Then in 365 days, there is revolution. There is no thread tied to the sun. It is on its own orbit. It could have sunk down. It would have gone up somewhere, but it is so nicely controlled by the sun and going around it. And this is happening for millions of years. Not one little mistake has been done. So much of perfect planning. And in the same way, electrons are going around the nucleus in the subatomic level. At the atomic level, you can see that everything, the weather, the rainy season, everything perfectly going on. So you can see that is why it's called cosmos. So has chaos created cosmos? Has just accidental mixing up of so many things happened? Is there not some intelligence which is doing all these things, which is creating, projecting all these things? So all this cosmos cannot come out of chaos. So there is some higher intelligence which is doing it. You call, the scientists call it intelligence, and some people call it God. That's all. What more proof do you want? So there is one of the vice presidents of India. While he was the vice president of India, later he became the president to Radhakrishnan. He demonstrated by one example about the existence of God. He gave the example of the strongest weightlifter of the Olympics. He may be lifting some 500 pounds, the heavyweight weightlifter. He may be lifting 500 pounds of weight, but can he lift the ground on which he stands? Try. You may not be a weightlifter. Okay, try to lift the ground on which you stand. So then, now the answer, the logic or reasoning is, a person who tells that I don't believe in God, first, if he has to tell those words, I don't believe in God, first that person has to exist. If the person himself doesn't exist, then how can he give the proclamation that God doesn't exist? What is God? Infinite existence absolute. The sum total of all existence. I exist, you exist. All the atheists who tell that God doesn't exist, they too exist. All the people, the devotees who believe in God, they too exist. Millions of creatures, millions of viruses, millions of living beings, plants exist. So the sum total of all existence and much more than that is God. That's why God is called Sat, infinite existence absolute. So if you have to deny the existence of God, first of all, you have to deny your own existence. With the same logic, your existence also will be denied. If you have to first exist to deny the existence of God, so your existence itself is a proof of the existence of God. So like that, there are so many stories, so many reasons, so many arguments by which logically you can prove that God exists. There was a minister, a politician, who went to inaugurate the 10th anniversary or the function. So what was that organization he went to inaugurate the 10th year celebration? It was a widows organization. Thousands of widows had come together and they had invested some money into that organization, widows organization, to do something good to the society and to the orphans and to the widows, to help them. So they were doing tremendous work, good work. So the minister, while speaking, the moment he got the mic, seeing that so much of work is being done in the widows organization, he was so much enthused. He started talking glibly. You know that the politicians make so many false promises and they will never keep. So now he too started making so many promises. They are doing wonderful work. I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. Finally, out of too much of enthusiasm, he told, today, this very moment, I will make, he showed his wife who was sitting there by his side, I will make my wife join this widow's organization immediately. All were dumbfounded, everything went silent. The minister didn't know what he was telling. He told that he will be making his wife join the widow's organization. So if his wife has to join that widow's organization, first he has to die. The minister has to die. If he doesn't die, how will the wife become the widow? Only then she will become eligible to join that widow's organization. So first the minister has to die, then only he can make his wife join the widow's organization. So it was a very complex and compound situation. Likewise, if anybody is denying the existence of God, first he has to deny his own existence. He should not exist to deny the existence of God. If he exists, that itself is the proof that God exists. So there are so many such things. I've only taken through some of the examples. Now let us proceed forward, studying the life, the wonderful life of Sharadananda Ji Maharaj. Once a disciple asked Sharadananda that another person instructs, another guru had instructed his disciple not to practice japam without taking a bath and etc. So many other rules and regulations. After such observances compulsorily, like you have to first take bath and then only take and then only do the japam. That is the instruction given by that particular guru to his disciple. To which Sharadananda replied, "The master came to make religion easy. People were being crushed under the weight of rules and regulations. To repeat the Lord's name or to worship God, no special time or place is necessary. In whatever condition one may be, one can take the name of the Lord. In whatever condition you may be." See, the realized soul, Sharadananda, is telling there is no condition. Ramakrishna has come this time as an avatara to make religion easy. People were being crushed under the weight of so many rules and regulations. That's why people are going away from religion. They don't believe in God because of these too many rules and regulations. They are crushed by it. Then Sharadananda is making a wonderful point here. To repeat the Lord's name or to worship God, there is no special time, there is no special place necessary. In whatever condition, one may be, one can take the name of the Lord. The name of the Lord itself is purifying. And then Sharadananda ji went on telling his disciples, the master Sri Ramakrishna never gave too much importance to these external observances. As to means, adopt whichever suits you best. If you like God with form, that will also lead you to the goal. If you like God without form, well and good, stick to it and you will progress. Then Sharadananda ji is making a wonderful point here. You will be surprised. And what is that? First of all, he told, if you like God with form, proceed forward, you will reach the goal. Stick on to it. If you don't like God with form, you want to see God without form, formless. Stick on to that, you will reach the goal. Then the next proclamation Sharadananda makes is very, very surprising. You will be wonderstruck. Then he tells, if you doubt the very existence of God, if you don't believe in God, then put the question to him. Then you put the question to God himself. Thus, I do not know whether you exist or not, whether you are formless or with form, but do please grant that I may know your real nature. You have all the freedom to believe that God doesn't exist. You have all the freedom to believe God exists with form, without form, or God itself doesn't exist. Don't worry. Even if you don't believe in the existence of God, then you question God. How to? If you doubt his very existence, then better put the question to God himself. Thus, I do not know whether you exist or not, whether you are formless or have taken form. Do please grant that I may know your real nature. Now about the fact, when the disciple asks that another guru is telling his disciple, you have to follow all these rules and regulations. You have to take bath early in the morning in that cold. You have to eat this much, this many times you should not eat. You should sit in this posture, you should sit here only, you should sit on the deer skin. You have to do your japa only with this mala, this type of mala, Tulsi mala or whatever I have given. So Sharadananda made it clear, the master came to this world to make religion easy. Religion is very simple. People are being crushed under the weight of rules and regulations. To repeat the Lord's name or to worship him, no special time, no special place is necessary. In whatever condition one may be, one can take his name. Sri Ramakrishna never gave much importance to these external observances. As to means, adopt whichever suits you best. Now, let us go to one of the rituals before beginning the puja. In the beginning of the puja every day, when we have to start the puja, we have to perform one ritual called Achamanam. We have done it, many of us, while doing the puja, we have done that Achamanam, whether puja or homa or havan. The person who worships or performs the homa has to go through this first ritual called Achamanam. In that, you will be made to sip Ganga water or whatever water, sacred water, to the hands in the palm like this in the Gokarna, in the shape of the ear of a cow, Gokarna. A drop, a grain of water is put and you sip it, telling the name of Lord Om Vishnu, or whatever name the Guru has taught you. Some people tell the name of Veda, some people tell Om Madhavaya Swaha, Govindaya Swaha, some people tell Om Vishnu, Om Vishnu. Whatever the tradition you follow, there you have to take the name of the Lord. Then after that, we tell the mantra. In our tradition, in Ramakrishna Puja Padati, in our ashrama, we have to take the name of Vishnu thrice. Om Vishnu, Om Vishnu, Om Vishnu. Then after that, we have to repeat the mantra. Om Tad Vishnu Ho Paramam Padam Sada Pashyanti Sureha Diviva Chakshura Tatam Om Apavitra Pavitrova Sarva Avastanga Topiva Yasmarit Pundari Kaksham Sabahya Bhyantar Hashuchihi. So we tell the mantra. We are doing that ritual for so many years, 30, 40 years, but you don't care to know what is the meaning of that mantra. What is the meaning of that mantra? The second part of this Achamana mantra, every day we are performing it, but we never want to know the meaning or the significance of the ritual. That is the reason why I have started past 1 year from the pandemic, the time pandemic started, I've started even one course called The Significance or the Science of Worship, where I explain all the details of what is the science behind worship, the puja, the mantra, everything. On Monday evening 6 to 7, we're doing that. So I have talked about this too. I have told the meaning of this mantra. What is that second part of the Achamana mantra? Om Apavitraha Pavitrova. You may be pure or impure. Apavitraha. Apavitra means impure. You may be impure in your thought, deed and word or whatever. In your body, you may be impure. Apavitraha pavitrova. You may be pure in your mind, body and speech. Sarva avasthang gataha apiva. You may be in whatever state, just like Sharadanandaji Maharaj told here, place or state of mind. What are the three states generally? The Jagrat, Swapna, Sushupti. Waking state, dream state and deep sleep state. And there are so many other states in between too. So whatever state you might be in, whichever state of mind or body you may be in, whether you may be pure, whether you may be impure, whether you may be in any state of mind, body or speech, Jagrat, Swapna, Sushupti, or whatever state you may be in, you can imagine any other state too in between. Apavitraha pavitrova sarva avasthangataha apiva yaha, whoever smaret, remembers or meditates or takes the name Pundarikaksham, whoever takes the name of the Lord, who has the eyes beautiful like that of a lotus, Pundarikaksham, the God's name, whoever remembers God or takes the name of the Lord, who has the beautiful eyes like that of the lotus, yaha smaret, the moment you remember, the moment you utter the name of the Lord and remember God, the moment, the very moment, what will happen? Yaha smaret Pundarikaksham, sa, he or she, bahya, externally, abhyantaraha, internally, shuchihi, that very second he becomes pure. Whatever state you may be in, whether you have taken bath or not taken bath, whether you may be impure or pure, whatever state you may be in, whichever state, the worst of the possibilities, the moment you take the name of the Lord, if you repeat once even the name of the Lord, what happens? Immediately, that very second, the moment you repeat the name of the Lord or remember God, sa, that person, bahya, externally, abhyantaraha, internally, shuchihi, becomes pure. You think that By putting on detergent and some other soap, you become pure. By taking water in that river, this river, you become pure. No. By remembering God, by taking the name of the Lord, by repetition of the name of the Lord, immediately you become pure internally and externally. That is the mantra we tell before the puja every day. So when you take the name of the Lord, it is so purifying. Just once, the name, you remember the name of the Lord with devotion, then you become pure internally and externally. I have seen with my own eyes one fine day. That was the day when revered Ranganathanandaji Maharaj, who was the president of the order at that time, he had come to Bangalore to give Mantra Diksha. So about 50 or 60 people were supposed to take the Mantra Diksha. All had come early in the morning at 7 o'clock. One lady came and she told, "I cannot take Mantra Diksha, I am going back, I am sorry." What is the reason? She was very repentant and very apologetic, and she was very much worried. She was sobbing. "Oh, I don't have the grace of the Lord. I cannot take." What happened? Because she had the menopause. So that in India, they believe that ladies, the mothers, when they have this menopause or menses, they are considered impure. And you should not do any worship or puja. You can't go inside the shrine. So many restrictions to the temple. Now, we were all handling the process there. We told, "Why don't you ask the Guru himself? Revered Ranganathanandaji Maharaj, he's a great soul. He's a great realized soul. Instead of you taking the decision of not taking the Mantra Diksha, why can't we ask Ranganathanandaji Maharaj himself? If he permits, you can take it. Why do you worry?" Then we took that mother to Ranganathanji Maharaj, who was then 92 years old, great soul. He was then the president of the whole order. When we presented that situation in front of him, we told, "Do not worry, mother. We are giving Mantra Diksha to purify you. The name of the Lord, when you get the mantra, that itself is the highest purifier. Whatever condition you may be in, the name of the Lord will purify you. So do not worry, do not fear. I will give you the assurance. Nothing is going to happen. Don't think that you are impure. You are the Atma Swarupa. Body only has got impure. By taking the name of the Lord, the body, the mind, everything can be pure. So I'm going to give you that mantra of the great Lord, that wonderful mantra, that it will make you pure for eternity. So don't worry of whatever external condition, whichever avastha you may be in, come and take the Mantra Diksha, you will be purified." And the mother took Mantra Diksha. She sat in the temple with all the other people and took the Mantra Diksha. So the name of the Lord, even once if you repeat, that will purify you internally and externally. So do not bother about too many rules and regulations. The name, repetition of the Lord name itself is purifying, the highest purifying agent. So much wonderful thing we have learned today, that the name of the Lord is the highest purifier. And Sharadanandaji's words also is so full of weight. Let us go through that again. The master came to make religion easy. People were being crushed under the weight of rules and regulations. To repeat the Lord's name or to worship him, no special time or place is necessary. In whatever condition one may be, one can take his name. We have heard somewhere in some other religion or some other sacred books of the other religion telling that you should not take the name of the God in vain. You should not worship, you should not do the mantra japa, take the name of the Lord in certain condition and other things. That is not true. Anytime, any condition, wherever you are, whatever condition you are, even at the time of the death. You may be in the gutter, you may be in the worst of the places. If you take the name of the Lord, you can take the name of the Lord, you can think of God, you can meditate on God in whatever condition, that will purify you internally and externally, your body, mind, and everything will become purified. So the master never gave too much importance to these external observances. As to means, adopt whichever suits you best. If you like God with form, that will also lead you to the goal. If you like God without form, well and good, stick to it and you will progress. So your internal longing is very important. I heard there was one atheist who didn't believe in God all through his life, and he was spreading that message of atheism to everybody. But during the time of death, he got afraid of death, afraid of the oblivion. What will happen to me after my death? Where am I going? All the life, he enjoyed the life by proclaiming that there is no God. But at the time of the death, just before death, he was so afraid of death. He didn't know what is going to happen. Where will he go? What will happen to him after the death? So he's so afraid, consumed with fear. Then that atheist started praying to God. Hear the prayer of the God, that atheist is wonderful. It happened. This is a real thing I'm telling about. The prayer of the atheist was, O Lord, if you exist, save my soul if it exists. Could you catch the prayer of the atheist? But very sincere. The prayer of the atheist was very sincere. How did he pray? O Lord, if you exist, save my soul if one exists. O Lord, if you exist, save my soul if it exists. What a sincere prayer, you see. So Sharadanandaji Maharaj proceeds to tell, if you like God without form, well and good, stick on to that. If you like God with form, that will also lead you to the goal. But if you doubt his very existence, then better put the question to God himself. He will make it clear how to put that question to God. I do not know whether you exist or not, whether you are formless or with form. Do please grant that I may know you, your real nature, how you are. Whether you exist or not exist, please show it to me. So now, after Sharadananda explaining about this nature of God, the disciple asked Sharadananda, Swamiji, have you realized God through mere work? Yes, we know that the saints have told, the rishis, the Vedas, the Shrutis have told by sadhana, by satsanga, by worship, by Jnana Marga, by Karma Yoga, one can realize God. Now, my pertinent question is, have any realized God through mere work? Has anybody realized God only by working, only by Karma Yoga? So to which Sharadanandaji Maharaj replied, through selfless work, that is unselfish work, that is Karma Yoga, the mind gets purified. And when the mind becomes pure, the knowledge and devotion arise in that person. Knowledge is the very nature of self. But being covered with ignorance, it is not manifest. So the object of selfless work, Karma Yoga, is to remove this covering of ignorance. As a matter of fact, knowledge dawns as soon as the mind becomes pure. In the Mahabharata, You have the story of the chaste woman who attained knowledge by serving her husband and by performing her other household duties as service to God. In the Bhagavad Gita, also you find one of the teachings of Lord Krishna. What is that? By work alone, King Janaka and others attained perfection. Janakadayaha. Where is this verse? It is in the third chapter, 20th verse. So we shall go through that. What is Lord Krishna telling about the work? So if we go through the words of Krishna, now Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is quoting the words of Lord Krishna and telling that by mere work you can get God realization. So now let us go to the third chapter, the 20th verse, and see what Lord Krishna is about to tell. So in the third chapter, that is the Karma Yoga, in the 20th verse, Lord Krishna is telling, Karmanaiva hi samsiddhim. Karmanaiva hi samsiddhim asthita janakadayaha lokasangraham eva api samsparshan kartum arhasi. So these are the words of Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita in the third chapter, 20th verse. Lord Krishna is telling men like Janaka and other people, they verily attained perfection, that is God realization, by work alone. So Lord Krishna is telling Arjuna, and through Arjuna to all of us, what is the words of advice of Lord Krishna? You, that is all of us, ought to work for the good of the world, having the example like Janaka and many other saints who have attained perfection only by work. So when Lord Krishna himself has told this, why do you have the doubt? By selfless work you can attain perfection, you can attain God realization. But you should have that sincerity. You should believe 100% whatever work you are doing, you are doing as an offering to God. You may be serving your husband, you may be serving your children, you may be serving your father and mother. It may be selfish work. You may be earning your money. You may be making profit, whatever. You may be a doctor, lawyer. Dedicate every aspect of your life. Do all the work as offering to God, and you can get perfection by that alone. So again, I will repeat the wonderful shloka which Sharadananda Ji Maharaj is quoting here from the Karma Yoga. In the third chapter, the 20th verse, you can also go and refer if you want. That's why I'm quoting the verse. Karmana eva hi samsiddhim. Karmana eva. That is how we have to break the words. Karmana eva is karmana eva. Karmana eva means, what is the meaning? Karmana eva, the stress Lord Krishna is putting, by work alone. See the words of Lord Krishna, Karmana eva, by work alone. Janakadayaha, men like Janaka and many other people. Janakadayaha, Janaka and many others. You know, the father of Sita was Janaka. He attained perfection, God realization, by work, by selfless work, by Karma Yoga itself. He would be the first person to go take the plow with the first rain to plow the land and produce like a farmer, though he was a king. Because the rest of the people should get inspired. Oh, our king himself is doing work, he is not lazy. So we too should follow. Then everybody will be active. The whole kingdom will be in prosperity. So Janaka himself be the first person to do all the work, even though he was a king. And that's how, while plowing, the plow got and stuck to a box, and when he opened the box, he got this wonderful daughter, the girl that is Mother Sita. That's how he got Sita, Mother Sita. So Janaka and many other people have attained perfection, God realization, only by selfless work. Karmanaiva, karmana eva, by work alone, samsiddhim, perfection. Janakadayaha, men like Janaka and others, astita, attained, he verily, lokasangraham, good of the society, good of the world, good of the people, serving the poor people, just like Ramakrishna is told, shivagnane jiva seva, seeing God in all the living beings, if you serve them, that is the fastest, easiest way to realize God. Again, I will stress it. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa is also told, shivagnane jiva seva, serving all the human beings, the living beings, seeing God, Lord Shiva or Narayana or Vishnu or Durga, whatever Ishta Devata, seeing God in all the living beings, if you serve, that is the easiest and the fastest way to reach God, perfection. What more proof do you want? Men like Janaka and many others verily attained to perfection by work alone. You ought to work for the good of the world. Unselfish work, selfless work has to be done by everybody. That is the surest way of mukti. Having their example in view. So Krishna himself has told, Ramakrishna has told, Vivekananda has told, now Sharadananda ji Maharaj is giving even by proof how you get perfection, you get God realization. When the disciple asked Sharadananda, has anybody realized God through mere work alone? To which Sharadananda ji Maharaj is replying, through selfless work. That is very, very important. Selfless, giving up your selfishness. Through selfless work, the mind gets purified. And when the mind becomes pure, what is there to be attained? You are already having the Atman within you, the knowledge of God already within you. Only it is covered by ignorance. Karma and Karma Yoga purifies that, removes the veil of ignorance. And what is there specially to get? Nothing. It is already yours. It will manifest, that's all. So knowledge and devotion arise in it when the mind becomes pure. And knowledge is the very nature of yourself. Your nature itself is knowledge, that is consciousness. But being covered with ignorance, it is not manifest. The object of karma, karma yoga, selfless work, is to remove this covering. As a matter of fact, Sharadananda ji Maharaj is telling, as a matter of fact, knowledge, jnana, dawns as soon as the mind becomes pure. And Sharadananda ji is giving the example of Mahabharata. In Mahabharata, you have the story of a chaste woman who attained knowledge, the realization of God, by serving her husband and by performing her household duties itself. Nowadays, many mothers, they don't want to be called as housewives. They like that they should be called as homemakers. You call them housewife, they will get angry. But here, there is an example in the Mahabharata of the chaste woman who attained God realization by doing the household work, by being a housewife, doing all the works of the housewife as dedication to the God. She got God realization. It is in the Mahabharata. You know the story of the yogi. went to the forest and sat there and did tapasya, austerities in the forest for 12 years, and he attained so many powers, miraculous powers, yogic powers. So one day he was sitting in meditation. A crow, which was sitting perching on the top of the tree, shit on his head. So the yogi got angry. How can these birds shit on my head? He looked at the bird with anger. Immediately, due to that power and the force, the concentration, the crow was burnt into ashes. Then the yogi became more egoistic. Oh, I have attained so much of power. So he came to the village to get alms, to beg alms. He went to one of the house and begged, Bhavati Bhiksham Nehi. O mother of the house, please give me alms. I'm hungry. So in India, when we are going to beg, especially the brahmacharins, the students have to go to begging. And even the first, when you are invested with the thread, the Yajnopavita, the sacred thread, then the brahmacharin has to do the first begging from the mother. It is considered the mother of the house is the representative of Annapurna, mother Annapurna, the wife of Lord Vishwanatha, Annapurneshwari. So we have to think that all the mothers in the house, when we go to the begging alms, to be the veritable manifestation of Annapurneshwari. So we have to tell the mantra, Bhavati, O mother. It is not Bhavataha. Bhavataha means Pullinga, male member. But while addressing, asking for the alms, we don't ask for the male members. We ask alms, any brahmacharin or sannyasin or anybody, we ask alms to the mother of the house. So that's why the word Bhavati. Bhavati means to the mother of the house, addressing the mother of the house as Annapurneshwari, herself, the divine mother. Bhavati Bhikshan Dehi. Please, mother of the house, give me the bhiksha, alms. So now this person asked for alms, and the wife from the inside shouted, blurted out, Oh Yogiji, please wait. My husband is sick. I'm serving my husband. I will finish the service to my husband and come immediately and give you alms. Please don't get upset. Please wait for some minutes. The yogi got angry. What? I'm such a great yogi. I have got so much of power. And this lady is making me wait. It's burning with anger, seething with anger. Then after some time, after serving, finishing the serving of the husband, the wife, the household wife, the grihini came out with the alms. Then by that time, the yogi was so much angry, seething with anger. He looked, stared at her with anger. Then immediately, in a smiling way, very calmly, the household, that housewife told, My dear Yogiji, I am not the crow to be burnt by your looks. Then the yogi was taken aback. How come? Did she know that I have burnt a crow with shit on my head in the forest? Then all his ego was crushed. He pleaded, Mother, he asked, sorry, apologized, and asked, How did you know, Mother, that I burnt a crow in the forest? You never were there. Then that household wife told, I have realized God. I have got all the yogic powers by simply serving my husband. I am a chaste wife, Pativrata. I have done my Pativrata Dharma by simply serving my husband, thinking that there is God in my husband. I am serving my husband. I am doing all the household works. Whatever work I am doing, cooking, sweeping, mopping, washing the cloth, everything I am doing, all the work, thinking that it is the dedication, worship of God. When I was a child, I looked after my father and mother as a veritable manifestation of God and served them. When brothers and sisters were born to me, I served them as the veritable manifestations of God. When I was married to this husband, I saw God in my husband and served him. And I'm doing all my work as worship of God, and that itself has given me God realization. I reached the perfection. That's how I could have the power to know that you have burnt that bird there in the forest. I can know everything, past, present, and future. So the yogi became surprised and told, "Oh mother, accept me as your disciple and give me the teaching." Then that mother told, "No, I am not your guru. I have my guru who taught me. You go there to another village at such and such a place. There is my guru in this address. Go and approach him. He is my guru. He has taught me this knowledge. And you go and become his disciple. He will teach you." Then he went in search of that address and was surprised to see that address led him to a butcher's house. The butcher was cutting the meat, cutting the animals, blood-soaked hands, was having that cleaver. Then he was selling that meat to the customers, he was arguing with him. Arguing with the customers, talking to them. Then he thought, might be I've come to the wrong address. The yogi wanted to go away. While he turned his back to go away, the butcher called, "Oh Yogiji, don't go away. You have come to the right address. I am that person. Wait for some time. I will come. I will finish all my duty and come." So he finished all this duty of the butchery and came out and took him to the house. He told Yogiji, "We shall go to our house." Then he took him to the house and told, "You have to wait for some time. I have my aged parents. I have to serve them." He served his aged parents. He did all the work and came back. "Now you can ask any questions. You can get my knowledge of the Atman and Paramatman." Then he started giving him the knowledge. Before that, he told how he got all the spiritual power, how he realized God, the Atman, the Parabrahman. Because he was a butcher, he was killing animals, which is papakarya, which we think cutting animals and killing animals and cutting the meat is papakarya. The work he does is very low, we think so. But he told, "I never desire that I should be born in the family of a butcher. It is the will of the God that put me into the family of the butchers. I never wanted to cut animals. The Lord wanted it. So I did the work of butchery, of cutting the animals, killing the animals, hunting the animals, and giving the meat to the customers. Even that act of butchery, I did as worship of God. So I saw God in the customers who have come and served them, gave them meat, doing every act of my butchery as a service to God. Then I started seeing God in my parents, in my wife, in my children, and started serving them. And this work, karma yoga, of doing every work as a dedication to God, worship of God, has given me this God realization. Then whatever flights of knowledge of the Atman and Paramatman he gave to that yogi has been recorded in Mahabharata, just like Bhagavad Gita, which Lord Krishna gives this wonderful knowledge of the Atman and Paramatman. In the Mahabharata itself, Vyasa Maharshi has placed it like that. There is one more. So many Gitas are there, Anugita, Uddhava Gita. There is one more Gita, that is Vyadha Gita. What is Vyadha? Vyadha means butcher. So butcher's Bhagavad Gita. So it has flight of knowledge of the Atman and Paramatman, the wonderful thing, the teaching given by that Vyadha, the butcher, to this yogi who did tapasya for 12 years. So both of them, the Grihini, the housewife, realized God by just serving her husband, seeing God in him and doing all the household work. In Mahabharata, that story is there in the Karma Yoga chapter of Complete Works of Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda mentions this story of Vyadha. So Vyadha also, by doing the work of butchery as a service to the God, and he has realized that God. So here, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is quoting that. Through selfless work, unselfish work, karma yoga, the mind gets purified, and when mind becomes pure, knowledge and devotion arise in it. Knowledge is very nature of the self. But being covered with ignorance, it is not manifest. The object of the selfless work is to remove the covering. As a matter of fact, knowledge dawns as soon as the mind becomes pure. In the Mahabharata, you have the story of the chaste woman, Grihini, who attained knowledge of God by serving her husband and by performing her household duties by the karma, by doing the karma of a housewife itself. She attained the chaste wife, the Grihini, in the Mahabharata story. And in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna himself tells in the 3rd chapter, 28th verse, the shloka, by work alone, karmanaiva hi samsiddhim, karmana eva. By work alone, King Janaka and many others attained perfection, realized God. And Krishna is telling, you also should do, taking this example, loka kalyana, good to the world, good to the society, good to the country, good to the people, good to the people, the service to the people. You will attain, just like Janaka and others, God realization by karmana eva, by work itself. By work alone, King Janaka and others attained perfection. Not one, but many have attained perfection through work. For Lord Krishna in Bhagavad Gita adds, and others also, not only Janaka. If it was only Janaka, if Lord Krishna had mentioned only Janaka, then it would have been a special exception. But Lord Krishna is adding the word Janaka Adayaha and many others. So after this answer of Sharadanandaji Maharaj, the disciple is asking, I am trying to follow all your instructions, but somehow I find that I am not quite at home in my spiritual practices. Sometimes it seems mechanical, monotonous, as if there is no life in whatever I do. So this is the problem of all the people. All the people will be asking this question. Everybody will feel like that. So let us see what Sharadanandaji is answering, and we get a wonderful point out of it. Disciple is asking Sharadanandaji Maharaj, I am trying to follow all your instructions, but somehow I find that I am not quite at home in my spiritual practices. Sometimes they seem mechanical, as if there is no life in the spiritual practices. To which Sharadananda replied, if you follow the same routine every day, it is only natural that you should feel so sometimes, the monotony, the drudgery, the mechanical way of the feeling, because you are doing it every day as a routine. If you follow the same routine every day, it is but natural that you should feel so sometimes. But then on those days when you like any particular portion of the sadhana, spiritual practice, devote yourself to that and let the other parts go. In this way, you may perhaps be neglecting particular practices for 3 or 4 days at a stretch, but that does not matter. When you renew these practices, you will find delight in them. So do not worry about the mechanical feeling or the monotony. Continue, do that, even though it is mechanical. Then after some days, that monotony will go away. You will find delight in your practices. You renew these practices, you will find delight in them. So now Sharadanandaji Maharaj is instructing how to meditate on God. Before you meditate, think of Sri Ramakrishna. If you do that, you will see whatever you do will yield good results. What a wonderful secret Sharadanandaji is giving. Before you sit for meditation, think of Master, think of Ramakrishna. What will you get by that? If you think of Master, if you think of Sri Ramakrishna, if you do that, you will see whatever you do will yield good result. Before meditation or any other work, if you think of Master Ramakrishna, if you do that, you will see Whatever you do will yield good results. Sometimes think that he is everything. Sometimes you can think that Ramakrishna is everything and he exists everywhere. That you are, as it were, immersed in him. Even as a pot is immersed in the ocean. Think thus, that supreme state of all pervading deity. The sages realize for all time, like the sky extending as far as the sight can go. He knows everything about you. You cannot hide anything from him. He knows even your innermost thoughts. So Sharadanandaji Maharaj is telling how to meditate. Before you meditate, think of Master. If you do that, you will see whatever you do will yield good results. Sometimes think that he is in everything and he exists everywhere. That you are, as it were, immersed in him, even as a pot is immersed in the ocean. Think thus, that supreme state of all pervading deity, the sages realize for all time, like the sky extending as far as the sight can go. He knows everything about you. You cannot hide anything from him. He knows even your innermost thoughts. Of course, one is much benefited by regular practices. If one practices regularly for some time, every day, one gains strength and finds pleasure in spiritual practices. In the beginning, it may look like monotonous or mechanical as a drudgery. But one is much benefited by regular practices. If one practices regularly for some time, every day, without fail, one gains strength and finds pleasure in spiritual practices. Now the disciple is asking Sharadananda, I have read much about Sri Ramakrishna. Through books, I have been able to know much about his life. Yet, when I think of his life, I do not find joy in it. Why is it so? The disciple is asking Sharadananda, I have read much about Sri Ramakrishna. Through books, I have been able to know much about his life. Yet, when I think of his life, I do not find joy in it. Why is it so? Sharadananda is replying, to find joy in anything, the brain and heart must unite. When does it give joy? When the intellect and the heart, emotions, unite together, then you get joy. So Sharadanandaji is replying, when he is not getting joy by thinking of Ramakrishna, to find joy in anything, the brain and the heart must unite. Just by intellect, through mere intellectualism, one does not get joy. Everything becomes lifeless by mere intellectualism. If you think only from the brain, you have to unite your brain with the heart, with emotions, with feelings. Through mere intellectualism, one does not get joy. Everything becomes lifeless by mere intellectualism. If what you have read about Sri Ramakrishna appeals also to your heart, that's why you have to connect it to your heart. You have to connect it to your life. If you have to connect it, identify it with your emotions. If what you have read about Ramakrishna appeals also to your heart, only then will you delight, you will get joy in thinking about his life. Until you connect whatever you have read with your life, start practicing it, you will not get joy. So what is the secret of getting the joy and delight? If what you have read about the master appeals also to your heart, connect it to your life. Only then will you delight in thinking about his life. He will then seem to be living. If you are just superfluously reading things, and if it just goes skin deep, it doesn't enter your life in your everyday action, if you don't practice whatever he tells, if what you have read about master appeals to you, your heart, only then will you delight in thinking about his life. He will then seem to be living. Through mere intellectualism, reading the book like a novel, or scintillation of the nerves will not do. Through mere intellectualism, one does not get joy. Everything becomes lifeless by just mere intellectualism. If what have you read about master appeals also to your heart, only then will you delight in thinking about his life. You will then seem to be living. Whenever there was an opportunity, young monks would ask questions of Sharadananda, either about their spiritual problems or about master's teachings. In January 1925, when Sharadananda was visiting Varanasi, that is Kashi, because that place, Kashi, is surrounded by two rivers. One is Varuna and Asi, another river is Asi. That's why that place, that landlocked place, is called Varanasi. And the other end is Mother Ganga. One side is Varuna, another side is Asi. Because of the two rivers covering that place, Varuna and Asi, it gets the name Varanasi. Because in Hindi, Vakara becomes Bakara, Va Ba. Yakara becomes Jakara, Yaja. So Varanasi has become Banaras. Va has become Banaras. That's why in some of the languages, Vishwanatha will become Vishwanath. Va becomes Ba. So Varanasi, Kashi, Banaras are all the same. So in January 1925, when Sharadananda was visiting Varanasi, some monks asked him the following questions. Monk B: Swami, the master has exhorted us to make the thought tally with our speech. What does it mean? Ramakrishna in the gospel has asked the spiritual aspirant, exhorted us to make thoughts tally with our speech. Mon muk akkura. Ramakrishna used to use that Bengali usage. Mon muk akkura. Mon means mind. Muk means mouth. Mouth means your speech, your words. That means your thoughts and your actions should be united. We will be thinking something in the mind. We will be doing something externally. That is hypocrisy. So whatever you feel within, if you are acting the same thing outside, that is what is told by Sri Ramakrishna as to make your thoughts tally with your outer action. So when that disciple asked in Varanasi 1925 to Sharadanandaji Maharaj, Swamiji, the master has exhorted us, that is spiritual aspirants, to make thoughts, our feelings tally with our speech. Mon mok akkora. What does that mean? To which Sharadananda replied, that you must be sincere. You must be sincere to yourself. You should be sincere to others. The meaning of uniting your thought and speech is that you must be sincere, that your inner life should tally with the outer life. You may tell something to others as teaching, but you will be doing something else in your life. But that doesn't tally. So you have to be sincere to yourself, and also at the same time you should be sincere to the other people too. So the meaning of that teaching of Sri Ramakrishna is that you must be sincere, that your inner life should tally with the outer life. To which that monk asked, it is naturally so. Whatever we speak, we think in our mind. We are doing that. Whatever we think, that is the thing which we are doing, because if we have to act, we are doing some actions. How does that happen? Because it comes as a thought. When we command, when my mind commands the muscles and the bodies and the hand, it works. So all the works which we do is coming from my thought. So it is natural, it is telling. Then why is Ramakrishna telling so? It is naturally so. Whatever we speak, we think in our mind. Without thinking in the mind, how can we speak? How can we do the work? When this doubt was expressed to Sharadananda, Sharadananda replied, do you think it is so easy? Do you really mean it? Do you think it is so easy? We chant the name of the Lord very superficially. We say while we are praying, O Lord, I am your servant and you are my master. While praying, we will tell all these wonderful words, bombastic words. With all that wonderful words, we pray. How do we pray? We say, O Lord, I am your servant and you are my master. I have renounced everything at your feet for you. I call you Lord, please grant me your vision. And at the same time, you are harboring bad thoughts in your minds. It does not work. As you speak, so you must think. As you speak, so you must think. In other words, while you take the name of the Lord, think of Him alone, not anything else. So now, Sharadanandaji Maharaj is showing us the fallacy of our thought, how we think something, we do something. By wonderful example, when that monk asked him, Swamiji, whatever we think, we do, we speak. Without the thought, how can we speak or how can we do things? Then to which Sharadanandaji Maharaj is replying, do you think it is so easy? We chant the name of the Lord very superficially. We pray to the Lord, O Lord, I am your servant and you are my master. But we are not at all ready to do any work of His. When it comes to the work, we'll escape, we'll run away. But when it comes to my family work, when it comes to serving your wife, oh, with so much of zeal you go and serve. When you serve your children, oh, you will pour in your heart and do that. But in the mouth, you'll be telling, oh, everything is master's work, everything is Ramakrishna's work. And we tell the prayer, we proclaim, we are the servants. But when it comes to the work of the master, we escape, we run away. in the mouth, in the action, when people are looking at us, oh, what a drama we make. But when it comes to service, when it comes to execution, we are nowhere. But when we are doing the work of the wife or the husband, oh, so much of zeal. But when it comes to the work of the master, no heart at all, haphazardly procrastinating things. We go on doing that work without any interest. But we claim, oh, we are devotees. Oh, master, we are the servant, you are the master. We have surrendered everything to your feet, but we will never give 1 cent or 1 shillong as donation or as service to the poor or Ramakrishna. We will not even shell out 1 single penny. We will be doing with conjusi, but when it comes to the service of the wife or the husband or the children, we will spend like water. But when it comes to Ramakrishna or God or temple, we take the rotten bananas, rotten coconuts, very low quality, cheap quality agarbattis. But when it is to serve the wife or the husband or the children, the best quality, the costliest thing, the costliest gold, diamond. But when it comes to God and temple and the service of the poor, used cloth, worn out cloth, we will cover it and we will do so much of ironing and washing and proclaim it with so much of this thing. Oh, that is the best quality of cloth. We have bought it and we give it. So now you can see the fallacy of our thought and work and deed. Yes, if you are doing it, please do it. Wonderful. Serve your wife, serve your husband, serve your children, serve your relatives with great care. Nobody tells that, but don't do the drama that, oh master, you are my everything, I'm your servant, I've surrendered. But in the contrary, in action, you have surrendered to somebody else, not to the Lord. We speak something, we do something. Do you think it is very easy to be sincere and surrendering? We chant the name of the Lord very superficially. We say, oh Lord, I am your servant and you are my master. I have renounced everything for you. I call you, Lord, please grant me your vision. And at the same time, we are harboring so many bad thoughts in our mind. It does not work that way. As you speak, so you must think. In other words, while you take the name of the Lord, think of him alone. So then Shardanandaji Maharaj is telling, the master used to say, having the knowledge of non-duality, your own, you can go wherever you like. What does it mean? Sri Ramakrishna used to tell, tie the knowledge of Parabrahman or God to the corner of your cloth and then jump into the life and do whatever you want. The master used to say, having knowledge of non-duality, Advaita Jnana, Parabrahma Jnana, Brahma Jnana, making it your own, that is realizing or having that knowledge at least, you can go wherever you like. What does that mean? When another Swami asked this question, Swami, yes, Sharadananda replied, not go wherever you like, but do whatever you like, was the statement of Ramakrishna. He corrected him, telling that Ramakrishna is told, having knowledge of non-duality, Advaita Jnana, your own, making it your own, it is not you can go wherever you like, but it is whatever you like, do whatever you like. Shardananji corrected him and he told, he meant evidently that after attaining supreme knowledge, you cannot commit any evil deed. When you are aware of God's presence all the time, everywhere, how can you commit the wrong thing? You cannot, because you know that God is seeing everything. You are aware of the knowledge. You are aware of the presence of God everywhere. Then how can you commit any sin? That is the meaning of what Ramakrishna told. Ramakrishna meant evidently that after attaining supreme knowledge, knowledge of God, one cannot commit any evil deed. How can one who has realized God or attained knowledge through discrimination, viveka, renunciation, vairagya, love, bhakti, prema, devotion, and purity, pavitrata, do any mischief? Therefore, after attaining non-dual knowledge, advaita jnana, whatever a person does, it must be good. That is the meaning of Ramakrishna saying, have the knowledge of God, advaita jnana, and then go do whatever you want. That is the meaning. Now, we shall stop our conversation here. And if you have any questions on what we have discussed today, you can ask. Any doubts, any question? Pranam Swamiji, what is the difference between karma and karma yoga? Now, karma means simply action. Whatever action we do, whatever work we do is karma. We are breathing, we are talking, we are standing up, we are getting up, we are going, moving, sitting, sleeping. Everything is karma. Every action we do is karma. We do the karma, we do any action goaded by our thought, our mind. I lift my hand like this because my mind commanded my muscles to do that, I lifted it. So action is done, anything action. So first it was in the form of the thought. Where did the thought come from? From me. I'm the owner, the ego. So I command. Why do I do that? Because I have some desire. So we work, we do all those things to fulfill our desire. So when we do all the action, all the karma for the sake of selfishness, to fulfill our desire. I work, I study, I go to the office, I go to the college, I go to the school to study. Why? Because in the future I want to earn money. Why? Because I want to fulfill my desire. So every action, all the work is done to even a dog, even a baby, even an animal, even a virus. It does something to fulfill its needs. So it is to fulfill our desire. So it is selfish. So all the works we do is for selfishness, to fulfill our desires, to get something. So karma is, most of the time, is selfish. And karma yoga is, we are doing that karma now for selfish ends. When you do that for realizing God, yoga means union. What is the meaning of yoga? Yoga comes from the root word yujir, yogi. Yujir means union. Yuj, from the yuj dhatu, yujir yogi. So the English word yoke, y-o-k-e, yoke, the English word yoke has come from yoga. What do you do? Yoking the bull. So the bull is yoked to the cart, is united. The bull is yoked to the cart. So it is union. So likewise, that yoke has come from this word yoga. The yoga has come from the word yujir. Yuj means to unite. So we want to unite this jivatman with paramatman. We want to unite with God. So when you do karma, when you do actions to unite with God, to realize God through your nature, true nature, that becomes yoga. If you do not for realization of God, to realize your desires for your selfish ends, then that action becomes bhoga, enjoyment. So any work with selfishness is bhoga, enjoyment. When you do it for God, for higher purpose, unselfish way to serve others, seeing God in others, becomes yoga for God. That is the difference. I think I'm clear. Any other questions? If there are no questions, then we can conclude with the prayer. Om Priyatam Pundarikakshah सर्वयज्ञेश्वरो हरिः तस्मिन् तुष्टे जगत्तुष्टं प्रीणिते प्रीणितं जगत् हरिः ओम तत्सत् श्रीरामकृष्णार्पणमस्तु।